probability is full of counterintuitive puzzles like the Monty Hall problem or the two envelopes paradox. One of my absolute favorites, though, comes from simple coin flips. Imagine flipping fair coins until you get two heads in a row, or as a separate experiment until the sequence heads-tails comes up. In this example, it took just two coin flips for heads-heads to come up, and it took four flips for heads-tails to come up. The question is, between heads-heads and heads-tails, which takes longer on average to appear? You would think that there would be absolutely no difference at all between these two. After all, heads and tails are supposed to be completely interchangeable, right? But let's see what happens if we simulate repeating this experiment many times. I'm keeping track of the results on these two histograms, which show the percent of the time each value comes up for both targets. Let's zoom in on the histogram a little, and let's speed up these coin flips a lot. As we repeat the experiment more and more, you notice that heads-heads and heads-tails truly are different. This is totally contrary to my intuition. If you were to flip exactly two coins, both targets have a 1 in 4 chance to appear. We can see this simple fact in our histogram. The probability of flipping exactly two coins is about 25% for both targets. Where our intuition fails us is on the values larger than 2. Here, the probabilities are very different between heads-heads and heads-tails. After 50 trials, we can already see the answer to our heads-heads versus heads-tails question. Heads-heads takes longer on average to appear than heads-tails. In our sample, heads-heads often took more than 10 flips to happen, but heads-tails never took more than 9. In fact, it seems that heads-heads takes an extra 2 whole coin flips on average to appear. Of course, this is all an approximation because we only did the experiment 50 times. In fact, it turns out that the true theoretical average number of flips for heads-heads is 6, and the true average for heads-tails is 4. It is not easy at first to see where these numbers come from. In the rest of the video, I'll present a beautiful theorem called the ABRACADABRA Theorem that lets you easily calculate these values of 6 and 4 and where they come from. The ABRACADABRA Theorem can also be used for any sequence of random variables, like dice rolls, or for a monkey typing random letters at a typewriter. And I'll do an example with these at the end of the video. If we use the notation bold E for expected value, also called average value, and N subscript some target sequence to denote the number of flips needed to reach that sequence, we can write the fact that heads-heads take 6 flips on average as the simple equation E N heads-heads equals 6. Similarly, E of N heads-tails equals 4. By symmetry between heads and tails, the expected value of N tails-tails is 6, and the expected value of N tails-heads is 4. The surprising thing, perhaps, is that this symmetry does not work between heads-heads and heads-tails. For some reason, two of a kind really is different than one of each. In fact, for longer sequences, things continue to be very counterintuitive. Consider playing the game with the target sequences of length 4. Let's compare the strings heads-heads-tails-tails and heads-tails-heads-tails. Can you guess which of these takes longer? Since heads-heads takes longer than heads-tails, and tails-tails also takes longer than heads-tails, then, logically, heads-heads-tails-tails should take longer than heads-tails-head-tails, right? Surprisingly, no! Here, the sequence head-tails-heads-tails is the slow one that takes longer on average, and heads-heads-tails-tails is the fast one that takes less flips on average. It turns out that heads-tails-heads-tails takes 20 flips on average, while heads-heads-tails-tails takes only 16. This is completely the opposite of what you would intuitively think by looking at heads-heads versus heads-tails. What's going on here? What's the pattern? By the end of the video, we'll develop a simple one-line method that allows you to calculate any of these expected values, and we'll totally explain the pattern here. Before we jump into the calculation, let's first develop some intuition. The key is to look at the partial progress towards the target sequence. For the sequence heads-tails, you either have no progress, for example when the last coin flip that came up was a tails, or you are halfway towards heads-tails when the last coin flip was a heads. Or you have finally reached heads-tails itself. We can think of these as abstract states of how much progress we have so far. Heads-heads has completely analogous states. The only difference between heads-tails and heads-heads is going to be found in the details of how we move around between these partial progress states. Starting from no progress, you have a 50% chance to flip a heads and move to the 1 out of 2 progress on the next flip. You have a 50% chance to flip a tails and stay at the 0 out of 2 progress state. This is identical for both heads-heads and for heads-tails. Similarly, starting from the halfway point, both sequences have a 50% chance to finish on the next flip. The only difference between the two sequences is what happens when you are at the 1 out of 2 state and you miss your next coin flip. For heads-tails, since missing means flipping another heads, you stay where you are at the 1 out of 2 state. You can think of this as a checkpoint where your progress is saved halfway towards heads-tails. On the other hand, for heads-heads, if you miss, that means you must have flipped a tails, and you have to go all the way back to the 0 out of 2 state. You now have to start all over and flip a heads again before you can progress. Clearly, it's going to be faster when your progress gets saved halfway. So by comparing these graphs, we can easily see that heads-tails should indeed be faster than heads-heads. However, it's not at all easy to see how this chart would produce the numbers 4 and 6 for the expected number of coin flips. For longer target sequences, like sequences of length 4 that we saw, it gets even more complicated. In the rest of the video, we will learn a completely different technique that lets us easily calculate the actual number of flips needed. The idea of the solution starts by imagining a fair casino. Unlike real casinos, which offer all sorts of tricky bets designed to bamboozle and swindle, this fair casino only offers one simple bet guaranteed to be fair. Specifically, the only bet on offer here is betting on the outcome of a single coin flip with even odds. 50% of the time, your coin comes up and you double your bet, and 50% of the time, your coin doesn't come up and you lose your bet. On average, you neither win or lose money with this bet. Of course, you might be asking right now, how would an imaginary casino help us with anything? Why should we imagine such a thing? The big mathematical tool that makes imaginary casinos useful to think about is the optional stopping theorem. This theorem tells you that no matter how you arrange bets at a fair casino, the profit is always zero on average. You can think of this theorem a bit like the law of conservation of energy. In the same way that conservation of energy prohibits the existence of a perpetual motion machine, the optional stopping theorem prohibits the existence of a profitable betting strategy at a fair casino. Both are a kind of no free lunch result that says you can't get something from nothing. Just like conservation of energy can be used in all sorts of useful ways beyond keeping perpetual motion trolls at bay, the optional stopping theorem is also useful for many calculations. For example, if you want to investigate a random variable x, and you could arrange a clever sequence of bets at a fair casino so that the profit was exactly x minus 4, then you can apply the optional stopping theorem and conclude that it must be that the expected value of x is 4. This is exactly the approach we will take with heads-heads versus heads-tails. We will set up a tricky betting strategy at a fair casino so that n heads-tails and n heads-heads appear as terms in the profit. Of course, as with any theorem, terms and conditions apply. Even the simple-sounding fact that you can't make profit at a fair casino can be false when infinities are involved. The St. Petersburg paradox and the Martingale betting system are two famous examples of this. For our problem, though, the theorem does apply, and we won't worry about the technicalities here. Here is the exact setup of the bets at the fair casino that will reveal that the average number of coin flips until heads-tails happens is 4. The casino flips coins and takes simple bets until heads-tails appears. When heads-tails appears, the casino closes and no more bets are placed. Before each flip, a new gambler arrives with exactly $1 in their pocket. This single dollar is the most money that each gambler can possibly lose at the casino. One flip at a time, each gambler will bet all their money, hoping that heads-tails will appear next, and they do this until they either lose all their money or the casino closes when heads-tails is reached. Specifically, each gambler is hoping for the following sequence of outcomes on the next two coin flips. First, they bet $1 on heads to come up. If they win that, they will double their bet and bet $2 on tails to come up next. If they win again, they will happily go home with $4. If at any point they lose either of these bets, then they are out of money and they go home empty-handed. Once again, it's worth emphasizing that this fair casino and these rules for how the gamblers were bet are completely imaginary. Nobody would really bet like this. Nevertheless, thinking carefully about this particular sequence of bets will reveal the average number of flips until heads-tails happens. It's a creative thought experiment that will lead to a slick solution through the power of the optional stopping theorem. To see how this all works, let's do an example. Suppose the flips at the casino come up tails, heads, 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 tails. Like forensic accountants, we can analyze the winnings and losses of these gamblers after the fact based on how these coins came up. We'll start both winnings and losses at $0 and then count up as we go through the coin flips that happened. Gambler number one arrives just before the first coin flip. He bets that the first coin flip will be a heads and immediately loses his $1. Gambler number two arrives just before the second coin is flipped and bets that this coin will come up heads. He wins this bet and then bets $2 that the third coin flip will be a tails. Since this coin came up heads, gambler number two loses the bet and goes home empty-handed. The net effect of gambler number two is to simply lose his original $1, so we record this as $1 in the losses. Gambler number 3 arrives just before the third coin flip and has exactly the same experience as gambler number 2. He wins his first bet, but loses his second bet and goes home empty-handed with a net loss of $1. Gambler number 4 arrives just before the fourth coin is flipped, bets that it will come up heads, wins this bet, and then bets that the fifth coin flip will be tails. He wins this bet too, and leaves the casino with $4 in winnings. For convenience, we will record his net profit of $3 as a loss of his original $1, and then winnings of $4. Like the first three gamblers, gambler number 5 arrives just before the fifth coin flip and loses his original $1. The casino is now closed because heads-tails has been reached. At the end of the day, we see that the casino took in $5 from these 5 gamblers, and paid out $4 in winnings to lucky gambler number 4, who completed the heads-tails sequence. All the other gamblers went completely bust because of their bet-it-all strategy. In fact, the same conclusion holds no matter what sequence of coin flips come up. The casino always takes in $1 for each gambler, so the losses are always the number of gamblers that arrived. But by our setup, the number of gamblers who arrive is precisely n heads-tails, the number of coin flips until heads-tails is reached. On the other hand, there's always exactly one gambler who gets some winnings. This is precisely the second-to-last gambler who gets lucky and arrives at exactly the right moment that heads-tails first appears. Our bets are exactly set up so that all of the other gamblers will lose their money and leave the casino empty-handed, except for this gambler. Having calculated the winnings and the losses, we are now ready to apply the optional stopping theorem. The profit is simply the winnings minus the losses, so 4 minus n heads tails. Since the expected profit must be 0 by the optional stopping theorem, we can rearrange to get that the expected value of n heads tails must be exactly 4. The exact same idea will show that the average number of coin flips until heads heads is reached is 6. The casino and the gamblers are set up in a completely analogous way as before, this time with the sequence heads-heads as the target sequence. The bets will proceed just as before, but this time there will be just one tiny little wrinkle in the carpet that will change the answer to 6 for heads-heads instead of just 4 like we saw for heads-tails. Can you spot what is going to be different? Pause the video if you want to try and figure it out before the solution is revealed. It's easiest to see what happens with an example. Let's suppose that the coin flips come out as tails, heads, tails, heads, heads. Just as before, the first three gamblers who arrive at the casino all lose their original $1, either by losing their first bet or their second bet. And just as before, lucky gambler number 4 wins 2 bets in a row and goes home with $4. The only difference between the heads-heads case and the heads-tails case is what happens to that very last gambler. In the heads-heads case, the last coin flip is a heads, and so this last gambler wins their first bet instead of losing it. They win $2. This last gambler would love to place another bet at the casino, but unfortunately the casino closes after coin flip number 5 here. Because of this, the gambler is forced to go home with $2 of winnings. In the heads-tails sequence we saw before, this last gambler had no winnings, just like everyone else. In summary, the total losses are n heads-heads, $1 for each gambler that bet, but the winnings are now $6. There are $4 from the second-to-last gambler who won both his bets, but now an extra $2 from the very last gambler who won their first bet and was sent home when the casino closed. Like we did before, we can now use the optional stopping theorem, which says that the average profit must be 0, to see that the expected value of n heads heads must be 6. Now that we've seen the setup, it's easy to generalize to longer sequences. For the target sequence heads tails heads tails, our gamblers are now hoping to win 4 coin flips in a row instead of just 2. They are hoping to double their money 4 times in a row and then leave the casino with $16. By the same arguments as before, the average number of coin flips until heads, tails, heads, tails comes up is simply the winnings these gamblers have at the end of the day. The remarkable thing to notice is that we can calculate what these winnings are by looking only at the last 4 coin flips, heads, tails, heads, tails. The details of how exactly the coin flips came up before this don't matter at all. This is because this is the first appearance of heads, tails, heads, tails, so by our setup, all the gamblers before this definitely lost their bets and left the casino with $0. We saw this happen to gamblers numbers 1, 2, and 3 in the earlier examples, and it will happen in general. For the sequence heads-tails-heads-tails, there is one gambler who wins 4 bets in a row and goes home with $16. The gambler after him loses their first bet. The gambler after that wins 2 bets in a row and has $4 in winnings when the casino closes. The last gambler loses their bet. So the average number of flips until heads-tails-heads-tails is exactly 20. 16 coming from the gambler who won 4 bets in a row, and then an extra 4 coming from the gambler who won 2 in a row when the casino closed. A very similar calculation works for the sequence heads, heads, tails, tails. Once again, we have only to calculate the winnings from the gamblers in the last 4 coins. As always, one lucky gambler wins all their bets and goes home with $16. But for heads, heads, tails, tails, all the other gamblers lose their bets before the casino closes. So the expected value of n heads heads tails tails is simply 16. Once you get the hang of this, you can easily calculate how long it takes for any target sequence in one line. For example, for the sequence heads heads heads, it takes 2 cubed plus 2 squared plus 2 to the power 1 coin flips on average to appear. This is because we have to pay out 3 gamblers. One who wins all 3 bets in a row, another who wins 2 in a row, and another who wins 1 bet on the very last heads. You can clearly see that the relevant factor to how long it will take is how substrings of the original sequence heads 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 fit into the end of the sequence itself. The same formula can be used for any sequence of random events, not just coin flips. For example, consider rolling 6-sided dice. How long will it take until we see the sequence 6, 6, 6? It's always going to be a sum of powers of 6, and this is because the fair casino for dice rolls pays out 6-to-1 odds on each bet, rather than the 2-to-1 odds as it was for coin flips. Like for heads, 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 for 3 sixes in a row, we are going to have to pay out 3 gamblers. One of them wins 3 bets in a row, another wins 2 bets in a row, and the last one wins just 1 bet in a row. Another example comes from the game Monopoly, where the random sequence now consists of rolls of 2 six-sided dice. In Monopoly, if you roll doubles 3 times in a row, you are said to be speeding and you get sent to jail. Since rolling a doubles with 2 six-sided dice has probability 1 out of 6, this is identical to the situation of rolling 3 sixes in a row. Another example is that of a monkey who types random letters at a typewriter. It is said that such a monkey will eventually type out the words of Shakespeare, but a very good question to ask is how long will it take? Since there are 26 letters to choose from, the average number of keystrokes until a particular word appears is always a sum of powers of 26. For the word abracadabra, the average number of keystrokes is the sum 26 to the power 11 from the full 11-letter word abracadabra, plus 26 to the power 4 for the last 4 letters abra, and an extra 26 to the power 1 from the very last letter a. This is an absolutely colossal number. If the monkey types one letter per second, it will take 116.4 million years on average for us to see the first occurrence of abracadabra. Shakespeare's famous 13-letter phrase, to be or not to be, takes a mere 78 billion years to appear at this speed. So it's true that the monkey typing randomly at a typewriter will eventually type out the words of Shakespeare, but you're going to be waiting for quite a while. This result is sometimes called the abracadabra theorem after this last example. A general version of the abracadabra theorem would look something like this. The general setup is observing a sequence of independent events where each outcome has probability p to appear. The average number of events until the first occurrence of some string of length k is 1 over p to the power k from the lucky gambler who wins all their bets, plus other powers of 1 over p for each matching substring inside the original string. These come from gamblers who have some winnings when the casino closes. I first saw proof of the abracadabra theorem in the book Probability with Martingales by David Williams. A martingale is just the mathematical name for the profit one has when betting at a fair casino, and there is a whole mathematical theory about them. This wonderful book presents many of the classical results in probability theory entirely using sequences of fair bets. Martingales are also commonly used in financial mathematics as part of modeling things like stocks and financial derivatives. There are many other exciting probability puzzles you can tackle with this tool, but we'll save those for another video.